नमस्कार, आई वुड लाइक टू वेलकम यू ऑल, रिस्पेक्टेड प्रोफेसर विष्णु प्रसाद शर्मा जी, रिस्पेक्टेड डॉक्टर एस एन चट्टोपाध्याय जी, डॉक्टर जयेश ठक्कर जी, माई फ्रेंड माई ब्रदर, डॉक्टर दीपाली देवी जी, डॉक्टर भवन चंद्र जी एंड अदर एमिनेंट स्पीकर्स, डॉक्टर परीक्षित देवनाथ, समादुर रहमान and Mr. Thanga Kumar from Thanga Naturals. This is a unique topic, Independent Research Ethics Society in association with Vishwa Ayurved Parishad, Imami, Jhandu, Ayush Darpan Foundation is moving ahead to touch the milestone of 200 on 22nd World Sanskrit Day. Today is our 192 webinar session. We have decided to celebrate Ayurveda with every celebrated day decided by WHO, UNO and other national and international bodies. Because Ayurveda cannot be limited to one day only, Dhanvantari Jayanti or Ayurveda Day. So this was our theme. And we are fortunate enough that we have been able to request for your valuable blessings, and blessings are there with us. So our this journey has been able to touch the milestone of 192 today. Today is one handloom day. World Handloom Day, how to relate with Ayurveda? It was a very bigger challenge. So we decided, as we are well aware that now various companies, various textiles have launched Ayurvedic Vastraj and Ayurvedic Herbal Dyeing. So that will be a unique subject where we Ayurvedic doctors will really be enlightened by the experts of this textile treasure. So now I would like to request Dr. Jayesh Thakkar, founder Jay Ayurveda and executive of Bengal Ayurveda Abhiyan, Bang Ayurveda Abhiyan and Vishwa Ayurveda Parishad, executive West Bengal. I would like to request him to moderate the session and invite our expert speakers to bless us, to enlighten us, to motivate us on the topic. Thank you and welcome.
Dr. Pawan Kumar Sharma sir, thank you and welcome all today on 192 Ayush Samriddhi webinar series. Today, as we know, is World Handloom Day, and we'll be celebrating it with Ayurveda, as every day we celebrate with Ayurveda, and we are grateful to Jhandu Imami, Vishwa Ayurveda Parishad, Ayush Darpan and Independent Research Ethics Society for organizing today's program. We have galaxy of speakers today, and we are excited to listen to them and to make this day colorful with Ayurveda and with their knowledge on natural clothes with herbal touch. So, without taking more time, we'll be starting with our first speaker of the day. Our first speaker of the day is Dr. Sambhunath Chattopadhyay. Dr. Sambhunath sir is from Kolkata. I'll be reading out a short brief about sir. Sir is a very well-known personality. Sir is a B.Tech, M.Tech, Ph.D., FIE, FTA, ARS. He is a principal scientist and head of chemical and biochemical processing division, ICAR, National Institute of Natural Fiber Engineering and Technology, Government of India, Kolkata. Sir has enrichment of jute and elite fiber science and his understanding of 32 years of dedicated services in formulation and implementation of different R&D projects. Sir has published lots of research papers, and sir has, to his credit, many presentations. Sir has written books, four books and 12 book chapters, 5 training manuals, and we have got sir have also reviewed 5 international journals. Indian Journal of Fiber and Textile Research, Pakistan Journal of Scientific and Industrial Research, fibers and polymers. And to name, sir, have also process developed as following single bath bleaching and dyeing of jute. Sir has reuse of reactive dye left out of after dyeing. Sir has dyeing of jute fabric, application of biotechnology for making handmade paper from jute, etc. Sustainable bleaching of jute using pericetic acid. So let me welcome sir for the topic coloration of natural fiber textiles with natural dyes. Dr. S. N. Chattopadhyay sir, you're welcome. The desk is yours. Please bless us with your knowledge and your guidance. Welcome, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. I am audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Good afternoon, respected Dr. Pavan Kumar, respected moderator, other panelists, and the persons, those who are on the video conference mode. I may be an odd man in this panel and very much thankful to the organizers for considering me as a panelist in today's webinar. Of course, I am a textile technologist, but I am a great admirer of Ayurveda. Today, I will share some of my experiences while working with natural dye. Actually, National Handloom Day is started from 2015, 7th August, and today is the 7th National Handloom Day. The day is celebrated to honor the lakhs of weavers spread throughout the country and their contribution to national economy. I am proud to say that 15% of the total textile production and exports are from this handloom sector only. And if we go back a few years, actually Swadeshi Andalan, that is nationalist movement, started at Calcutta Town Hall on 7th August 1905 with the slogan to remove foreign made textiles and to use mota kapra, that is coarse cloth made of handloom. And in order to recognize that special day, our Honorable Prime Minister has announced this in 2015, this auspicious day as our National Handloom Day. We love anything colorful in this universe, and textile is one of them. Any textile product, starting from apparel to lifestyle, it must be colored with dye to make them appealing to the customer. In most of the cases, these are colored with synthetic dyes, but in the total life cycle of these synthetic dyes, they produce lots of pollution. Even during production, during use, being harmful to the skin, and after use, they cause damage to the soil. So, as an complementary to natural dye, is may find some place in of natural fiber textile, not as a competitor, but to some extent, we can avoid our natural dye to replace the synthetic dye. Sir, today I will speak on coloration of natural fiber textiles using natural dyes. Actually, our moderator, sir, has already told, I am a principal scientist and head of division of National Institute of Natural Fiber Engineering and Technology. This institute is situated in Kolkata, and we are dealing with all the natural fibers, starting from jute, leaf, sisal, rami, pineapple, flax, any natural fiber except cotton we are dealing with. And we are post-harvest technological institute. That means engineering aspect of these fibers we use to take care of. And we have developed so many technologies. And we are proud to say that we are now crossing 83 years of our existence in this part of this world. And we are working in the processing of these natural fibers. Actually, according to the definition, Dyers and Colorists UK, natural dyes are obtained from plant, animal, and mineral resources It has little or no chemical processing at all. Most of these dyes are called modern dyes. I will say in short what is modern dyes and other chemical classes of dyes which are used in synthetic dyes. They are not available in natural class of dyes. And what is the advantages of this natural dye? Mostly they are from renewable resources, no health hazard. Sometimes this natural dye, they act as health care also. No or mild chemical reaction involved in their preparation. That means during extraction, it is very mild process. No disposal problem after use of the natural dye and the natural dye product, fabric, textiles, anything else we can throw to the soil, but it will go to the soil and it will not cause any harmful chemicals on the surface of our earth, causing pollution to the aquatic and also the agricultural sector. And a lot of creativity is there while using natural dyes. That is the one beauty of this natural dye. But there are also some disadvantages of this natural dyes, like lesser availability. Actually, we cannot compete with the synthetic dyes. We can share a part of their use using natural dyes, and this natural dye product use should be very specific, niche, and also to be used judiciously where it is actually needed, not everywhere. Second thing is that color yield is poor. That means the amount of the dye required to get a particular color of said is high compared to that required by using synthetic dyes. And dyeing process is somewhat lengthier in natural dyeing. And another important thing is there, reproducibility of the shades. That means today you are producing one color with some natural dyes, and tomorrow or day after tomorrow you are producing another batches of natural dye fabric using the same dye, but there may be somewhat difference in the color or the shades. You have to accept it. This is the beauty of this natural dye. That is, reproducibility of shade may not be that much good. There is batch to batch variation, but this is not a defect. Limited number of shade compared to synthetic dyes, you cannot dye and get color anything else. There is some limitation in the shades. Only wool, silk, linen, and cotton is generally dyed. Synthetic fibers are generally not dyed or not suitable for dyeing with the natural dyes. And also blending of dye. That means to get some complex shade using some mixing of the color, there is some also difficulty. And inadequate fastness properties. That means the fastness of the dyed fabric is somewhat lower. Fastness in the terms of washing fastness, rubbing fastness, and also light fastness. It is somewhat lower. What are the origin of natural dyes? Natural dye origins are three. One is the vegetable origin, another is the animal origin, another is the mineral origin. From vegetable origin, that means the coloring matter we get from root of a tree, leaf, bark of the tree, trunk or fruits of the plants. There are three different classes of vegetable natural dyes: direct, modern, and VAP. Direct means directly you can apply to the fabric. In case of modern dyes, before dyeing, you have to do another additional process that is called modern thing process. I will say in short in later slides, that is the direct dyes that does not require any additional treatment. Example may be turmeric, safflower, annatto, this type of thing. And modern dyes are those dyes which require some additional treatment before dyeing in order to dye the fabric in a deep color, fast color for this purpose. And example, if you say, I can say Manjista, Ratanjot, Babul, these are some of the dyes which can be dyed after modernizing of the fabric. Another important dye that is called the VAT class of dyes. You might be knowing indigo. Indigo is a blue color that is often from the nature and the plant. And these VAT dyes are very good in fastness properties and so also color. And there is some specific method of preparation of this VAT dye. That is, indigo blue is an example of this class of dyes. These are all vegetable color. Now, animal color from the lac, cochineal, carnis, we can get, all these are insect. From this, we can get very good color. They are called animal. And mineral origin, different salts, metal oxides, there the mineral color, that is khaki, then red, indigo, that is the metal red, and all these things are mineral color. Natural color, we need to do first extraction, because total material we received from my mother nature is not the total dye. We have to extract the color from the basic raw material. And what are the method? There are different type of method. First of all, if we consider the vegetable origin from plant resources, that is bark, root, seed, leaf, etc., then first thing is that we have to dry it properly. And after drying, we have to remove all the dust, dirt, other particles from it to make it free from any other impurities. Second stage is the extraction stage. Extraction stage, I will say, most simple process is the aqueous extraction method. That means you have to powder the dried vegetable mass, put it in the water, boil it, and extract the dye. And you will get the dye after boiling. So aqueous extraction method I will suggest, and in later slides I will discuss about a few regarding how to get extraction by aqueous process. Two or three things is the most important for extraction of color. One is the temperature of extraction, that is from liquid, what temperature we will be extracting. Second is the time, that is the duration of boiling or heating. What is the time required? Another important thing is that pH of the liquor, whether it will be acidic, whether it will be alkaline or neutral. Another important thing we have to keep in mind, material to liquor ratio. Suppose we have used a certain amount of biomass, then what will be the total quantity of water we use? That is also a factor. So temperature, time, pH, material to liquor ratio, and these things are very much important for extraction of the color. And I told you, modern thing of process is done in some cases. And I will say, most of the natural dye, they require modern thing. That means one particular treatment before dyeing. And that can be done by different methods. I will say few eco-friendly methods. One is using metallic modern. That means alum, ferrous sulfate, stannous chloride, etc. These are treated on the fabric before dyeing. Another is the vegetable modern. that is extract from myrogolan, pomegranate, etc. And another is the oil-based modern, that is the Turkey red oil. But I will suggest and I will show the slides how it is done using metallic moderns and vegetable modern in later slides. Now, dyeing methods are five principal methods of dyeing using natural dye. First of all, material is boiled, first moderned, and then it is dyed in a fresh dye bath. That means moderning can be done before coloration. Another important process are there, moderning can also be done after the dyeing. Main objective of moderning is that it is like a coupling agent. One hand it will catch the fabric, another hand it will catch the natural dye. So this coupling agent, that is moderning treatment, can be done before dyeing, then dye, or coloration is done first, then apply the modern. Another process is there, both together, that is called dyeing and moderning together in the same bath. So different styles there according to our convenience, nature of the dye, and also the dyed material which we are going to produce. All these factors plays important role in it. Now, one is thing that washing fastness of the most of the natural dye material is poor, but we can improve this by using moderning technique, what I told, either before dyeing or after dyeing or during dyeing. We can improve the washing fastness property of the natural dyed material. Now, this slide is showing very important criteria. That means the fabric before dyeing and moderning must look white. This is the natural fabric look, but before coloration, you have to make it white. How we will make this white? That is a big chapter. One thing I will say, by the process of bleaching. And this bleaching process can be done using different oxidizing bleaching agent. Two examples which is very much popular, and also from our institute, we have developed several technologies for natural fiber. One is hydrogen peroxide bleaching. Another is the peracetic acid bleaching. Both the bleaching process are eco-friendly and easily can be done by any artisan, small dyer, and any small scale unit. Thing is that I told you, modern we have used ferrous sulfate, potass alum as a chemical modern, or myrobolan and pomegranate as a bio modern. Now, how to use it? What is there? Now, myrobolan, the fruit, it is very rich in tannin. This myrobolan, that is Tarmillina cebula, and it is in Hindi, it is harda, and English, it is called myrobolan. The fruits of myrobolan is rich in tannin. This tannic acid mostly used for creating affinity for dyes and fabric. That is, tannic acid present in the myrobolan is the main agent which is acting as a coupling agent for both the dyes and the fabric. Now, how we do it? Myrobolan is...
Hariom, sir. Slightly faster, sir. Five speakers are there. Slightly faster.
Okay. I will go faster. That is, one is the myrobolan is there. Another is the pomegranate, and that is the pomegranate, that is the rind of the pomegranate. Upar ka jo chilka hota hai, usko leke, that is the extraction is to be done. Now, I have considered some natural dyes which are Manjista, Ratanjot, Anato, and Babul, and they have some chemical classes, and also the parts from where these are collected. Manjista is collected from root, Ratanjot bark, Anato seed, and Babul bark. I told you that is the aqueous extraction method that has been collected. And chemical modern is applied in the ratio of material to liquor 1:20 at 80 degrees centigrade for 30 minutes. And after the treatment, it is squeezed and taken. Now, application of biomodant is the same way, myrobalan and pomegranate. One thing is that after application of modern, you have to squeeze and dry it, no washing in between. After modanting, the jute fabric is used for dyeing. Now, after coloration, that is the dyeing of the natural dye material, there are several methods of testing, because you have to taste how much color has taken and what is the fastness property of these colors and all these things. And we find that if we go through it, and extraction process, I will go first, that is the Anato, it is alkaline medium is the best. For Ratanjot, alkaline, Babul, neutral, and Manjista, neutral. Now, thing is that both the modern can be dyed together, and you have seen that is the control without modern thing. If we get a color value, any unit, it is 1.7, but after modern thing, the fastness and also the color value increases about 6 times, 12. So, modanting is required. I am going first. Now, washing fastness also, there is an improvement after modanting. That means, in the scale of 0 to 5, we get without modanting 2 to 3, but after modanting 4. That means, 2 grades improve. Light fastness to some extent improve, and also the rubbing fastness. So, modanting before natural dyeing is very essential. Now I am coming first, and these are some example of jute fabric dyed with Anato color. How beautiful it is, and also this is dyed with the Ratanjot. Now this is sandalwood. Sandalwood also produces very good, very nice sandal color. And this is the Babul, that is the bark of the Arjun and Babul tea we can use. And this is Manjista, very bright red color. And also the only Anato color it is producing this. And different types of items can be produced out of this. Now, these are the different type of bags, and we can make healthy bags, natural diet can be produced. Another important thing I am going first, that is the natural dye has an unique property. That is, it has the property of UV protection. UV protection is the newer innovation and beginning to get momentum in the performance textile. So a time will come, we'll go and purchase items from the market by knowing its UV protection property. Because UV protection of the textiles, that is the herbal textile, is very much important, that will protect our skin. And if we see, UV radiation has different type of rays, you know all in the Ayurveda Shastra also, UVA, UVB, and UVC. Now, using this natural dye, it can be protected. UVB, that is the most harmful radiation coming from the sun, it can protect, and this also protect the skin cancer. And typically, I can say that after this type of treatment and coloration, we can get 25, 20, 30, 35 UPF rating. That is due to the natural color, natural dyes can ability to protect UV rays from the sun. So it is also have some healing effect. So the umbrellas of this type to be, if you use in the sun, it can protect us. It can protect these items also from the UV rays. Another important property of the natural dye product we have studied at our laboratory It has got a very good antimicrobial activity against gram positive and negative. And we have studied the diet material, and we can find that the bacterial count can be reduced by 64 to 68% by using this natural dyed fabrics. And this type of product, antimicrobial and UV resistant toys, can be produced for the children. And also different type of home appliances can also produce, can protect from the different type of microbial attack. So in conclusion, I can say natural dye can be used for level color. That means uniform coloration throughout the fabric using natural dyes. Modern thing is essential for dyeing. That is, modern thing, chemical treatment before dyeing is needed. Natural dyed fabrics have very good and excellent UV protection properties. Natural dyed fabric produce satisfactory antimicrobial activity against gram positive and negative. And also a variety of eco-friendly products can be made out of these natural dyed fabrics. And thank you for giving me this opportunity to speak before you in nutshell. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Sambhunath sir, for a unique presentation. Really, we came to know many new things from your presentation, and I'm sure that people watching today and later on in our YouTube channel will be happy to know all you have discussed today. Moving on to our next speaker of the day, Dr. Bhuban C. Sir is from Assam. Sir is assistant professor in postgraduate department of zoology. And let me read out brief about sir. Hello, Dr. Bhuban C, sir.
Yes, am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible. Sir, to introduce sir is a postgraduate in zoology with specialization in endocrinology and reproductive physiology. He has completed his PhD in biodiversity, ecology, and conservation strategies of wild silk moths in Nagaland. Sir has more than 16 years of research experience in the field of non-mulberry or wild or vanilla sericulture, and 2 years of research experience in the field of biological control of tea pest in various premier institutes. Sir have successfully completed the research projects by DST, Government of India, New Delhi, Government of Assam, Guwahati, and sir have been attending 35 conferences, seminar, workshops of national and international level. Sir has to his credit 5 seminars as resource person. He has published more than 26 research papers and 10 scientific articles. Sir have been awarded with Nagaland University Best PhD Thesis, Assam Sahitya Sabhya Dharitri Dharak Bota 2019. Sir has recognizations from various universities. Sir has professional membership to more than 12 international and national. And now we are very much glad to welcome sir, who has got lots of administrative responsibilities also, to speak on today's topic. Sir, you're welcome. The desk is yours.
Yeah, thank you so much for the nice introduction. Respected Prabhan Kumar Sharma sir, and respected panelists of the today's afternoon session. And I, on behalf of Nagaon College fraternity, offered my best wishes to National Handloom Day, all participants joining through virtual platform. And thank you once again, Ayush Samyuddhi webinar series, for inviting me, sharing my views. And I want to share my skin.
Yes, sir, you can share.
Is it coming?
Still not.
Is it?
Yeah, sir, now it's visible. You can put it in full screen and start your presentation. Thank you.
Okay. Is it coming in white screen?
Yes, it is coming. time duration okay. Maximum 20 minutes, so please kindly consider.
Okay. So I want to present my topic, plant-based natural dyes for dyeing airy silk yarn by ethnic people of Assam, a sustainable livelihood generation. So I am not going to details about natural dyes because my previous speaker already mentioned what is natural dyes, their advantage and disadvantages also. So I'm directly go to the what is agriculture. The name Eri derives from the Assamese word era, which means the castor oil plant, primary food plants of this worm. According to some authors, the word it comes from the word Eranda, an ancient Sanskrit name for the castor plant. The history of agriculture is not known. It is believed to have originated in India. The inhabitants of northeastern India, particularly the northeastern state, practice agriculture from time immemorial. So various tribes of Mongolian or Tibetan Burma origin like Boros, Garos, Mikis, Karbis, Rabhas, Kasaris are engaged in this cottage industry. Apart from economic importance of eri fiber, production of worm and pupa are known as lepra in Assamese of the moths are also consumed as food. Scientific name Erysilcum samia ricini donovan. Erysilcum of genus samia contains 19 species, out of which samia ricini is purely domesticated. Beside castor plant, it feeds on many other food plants which are considered to be secondary and tertiary food plants. Thus, Erysilcum is said to be polyphagous in nature. Agriculture is native to northeastern region of India. So far reported 10 food plants, main food plants castor, keseru, and tapioca. So life cycle of Erysilcum. The uses of silk samia is embedded with cultural heritage of people of northeastern region of India. Also, agriculture is agro-based small-scale industry in northeast India. It is a traditional and leisure time occupation meant to meet partly the clothing and dietary needs of the sericulture family. The Muga and agriculture provide occupation to nearly 2 lakh families at present, where involvement of weaker section of the society is about 52.4%, SC 40.9%, and ST 11%. More precisely, the culture provides employment to women folk, which comprise 65%. The rearing of Eri silkworm, Samia ricini donovan, for production of Eri silk, culturally associated with the different ethnic groups of Assam. Women, every ethnic groups of Assam have perfected ways of coloring the object with dyes extracted from locally available plants and fixing them on to the different bases. The state Assam has a large number of major tribes and sub-tribes broadly belonging to the Indo-Mongoloid racial stock, include ethnic groups like Thai Ahom, Kasaris, Rabhas, Sutiyas, Bodos, Tiwas, Soronia Kasaris, Mes Kasaris, Tengal Kasaris, Deuri, etc., with varied composition of cultural diversity. These ethnic people have rich and traditional knowledge of dyeing cloths and other materials from time immemorial using different locally available plants. In a recent study, reported 44 numbers of plants traditionally used for natural dyes by 13 communities of Assam. I am just sharing this dye-yielding plants, which used traditionally used by different communities, suppose Khamtis, Missing, Devris. I am not going details about the list because 44 plants. In my recent study, used by different ethnic groups like Devris, Thengal Kosaris, Sunwal Kosaris, Tiwa Kosaris, Karbis, Bodus, Garus, Rabhas, Motok, Moran, and Kayam. Okay. So these are the some plants which you have already known some plants traditionally used by ethnic people of Assam for dyeing of their especially eri silk fiber. Okay. The why plant based natural dye? Previous speaker already mentioned this advantages and disadvantages of the this natural dye and natural dye even time also very limited. So
your net is weak, sir. Please off your video so your voice can be continued. Your voice is interrupting, sir. Dr. Bhuvanji, please stop your video and continue. Jayashji, please look into the
hello.
Because it is a plan 14.
Hello. Plan. Dr. Bhuvan, sir.
Yes. Sir, is it audible? Yes.
Sir, due to network. Yeah, it's audible. Please switch off your video and then start your presentation.
Yeah, I have already switched off my video. Is it now? Is it
now
okay?
Now you restart the presentation. Yeah, it's okay. Now a little bit better.
Okay. Okay.
Fine. You can continue now, sir. Okay.
Yeah. So I am showing this slide 13. Think you are developers. I'm just yes. Physical properties of natural dye directly or indirectly play high role in quality production and silk product. The color first and color fastness to rubbing is found to be satisfactory in all sample except for one sample, Terminalia sibula. Bixa origina shows a low level of color fastness to us. These are physical properties of natural dye. This slide. Okay, so I am not going in a laboratory for the extraction procedures. Plant. So accordingly, I am showing this natural dye tested on eri fibers in the laboratory and field. And did very right in the village omens. they are used to extract natural dye from different plant sources, and we taught them the how to extract natural dyes from plant and how to use in airy fibers. So yeah, accordingly these are the, they have already weaving also, and they extracted plant natural dye, and they are used in their silk fiber and ultimately weaving also. So because one of the another important agriculture also means that out of 63,000 in India villages and is providing livelihood to 1,000 families. So accordingly, more than 9 in Assam, in Red Assam, 9 providing employment to 2.5 families. So these are the statistics of the silk production, boiner silk production, so central silk sources and prices of boiner silk, raw silk coupons and raw silk. So accordingly, by rearing of 100 DFLs throughout the different season, one rearer can earn 1 lakh in a year from rearing only, not from the silk products on rearing and selling the pupas and coupons also. I'm just showing the village women engaged in rearing of airy silkworm. Accordingly, I taught them how to rear in scientific manner, and also the pupa they extract from coupons for selling, which is very delicious in northeastern region of India, high protein. This slide, I want to show the economics of from airy silkworm rearing by rural women. I have already mentioned that systematic rearing throughout the season, because I have all throughout the different seasons of in a year. Suppose 5 to 6 from only coupons and you are 90 100 approximately from their rearing. Apart from this, difference is there. So I'm also concerned here, and some of the products which is already available, and these are very important. So earlier slides I have shown only the airy silk product, traditional airy silk products, and now if it is dyed with natural dye, natural plant natural dye, then we can these are the this product my village women already have. Cloths, suppose waistcoat and even stole they made like this. So these are I just want to show one story that one Bangalore village, a very remote village, Manoha Morigaon district to Delhi International Trade Fair. After using of natural dyes on airy silk fibers, weavers able to produce various types of diversified products such as Tadar Mekhala, traditional Assamese woman stall, muffler, waistcoat, curtain, cushion cover, etc., which were limited to only airy shawl for men earlier. From these diversified products, they were able to grab a good market in district fairs, a handloom exhibition, national and international trade fair. I'm just showing this how they can develop right from the rearing to natural dye airy product, how they can able to achieve able to grab the international and national market. they are successfully doing in their remote villages, and their product already sell in international and national level trade fair also. They have already export their products in Australia, France also. So these are the some natural dyed airy silk products. In this slide, I'm just want to show some of the natural dyed airy silk product and their price. So I'm showing the muffler, suppose natural dyed from marigold, mehendi, betel nut, lag, indigo. And the price of the that particular muffler 600 to 1100. So accordingly, scarf and other products also. Suppose Sadar Mekhala shirt and cushion cover, very popular in international market, that cushion cover also. Again, these are the some products which made by our village women using natural dye, plant-based natural dye. So in this slide, I'm just this successfully covered our local media, how that village women achieve using natural dye, airy silk fiber in national and international market. So now if we see the potential of this industry, so from the recent study, it is found that although various plants are being used by traditional artisans, but there are no documented forms available to study. Only a handful of fragmented reports are available. Hence, it is utmost necessary to document this resource and their uses as early as possible. Plant-based natural dye has a huge potential on dyeing of airy silk, and also production of airy silk diversified product. Thank you once again giving me this opportunity to share my thoughts about plant-based natural dye for dyeing of airy silk fiber and for livelihood generation. Thank you once again. Over to moderator. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Bhuvan sir, for a nice presentation. We had a very good idea. So there were some network glitches, but the presentation was excellent, and we would also like to know more in future from you, sir. Now, moving on to our next speaker of the day. Yeah, welcome, sir. Moving on to the next speaker of our day, Ms. Anisa Khiani. Madam is Founder Director, Organic Symmetry, Designer Consultant, Charaka Women's Cooperative Society from Karnataka. Madam? Hello?
Hello?
Let me, thank you, ma'am. Let me read a brief about Madam. Madam is a Master's in Apparel Design from National Institute of Design. She is designer and sustainable fashion advocate. She is design consultant working with clothing brands to make garments from natural fabrics, handloom, and ayur vastra. She is design consultant at Charaka Women's Cooperative Society. It is India's biggest natural and handloom fabric producer, supporting 1,200 weavers and women. She is founder and director of Organic Symmetry, a clothing brand that makes clothes from natural materials, organic dyes, and materials. She is partner at Mellow Designs, working towards marketing and promoting sustainable businesses and brands. She has worked on various projects for research and upliftment of handloom and textile crafts of India. Her work on vegan leather and particularly Ayur Vastra is commendable. And soon, she is to launch Pavitra Vastra, Ayurvedic dyed fibers. Our best wishes to her, and we take pleasure to invite her today on our session. Welcome, ma'am. The dais is yours. Please share your experiences and knowledge with us.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Jay, sir. And thank you, Pavan, sir, for inviting me for this presentation. So there are so many panelists who are, you know, very much experienced than I am. I am mostly the youngest in this panel, and maybe I don't have so much experience, but since I come from an apparel and clothing industry, I would like to share what I feel as a designer and as a person who promotes handloom and handcraft sector and natural dyeing. So before starting my presentation, I would just like to tell you that I have been working with a lot of projects, and as Jay sir mentioned that we are going to launch Ayurvastra and Pavitra Vastra. So that is a project that that is being done by Charaka Women's Cooperative Society. So it is based in rural parts of Karnataka, and they have been doing a lot of experimentation and research on natural dyeing, and they have been doing natural dyeing since so many years. Then apart from that, coming from a design background, I would like to show that since other panelists have already shown that what and how natural dyes are important and how natural dyes are beneficial for our health and our environment, I would like to take a note on how we as a consumer can change our thoughts while buying clothes and products that are naturally made and handmade. So I'll start my presentation with that. So I'll stop my video and start my presentation. Hope I can make you understand more about how as a consumer we can behave.
If your internet quality is good, madam, you can definitely on the video also.
Yes, yes. Can you see my screen now?
Can see your screen?
Yes. Okay, okay.
If you could also keep your camera.
Welcome to VoiceOver. Yeah, my camera is off.
VoiceOver speaks descriptions of items on the screen and can be used to control the computer using only your keyboard. If you already know how to use VoiceOver, press the V key now.
Okay.
If you want to learn how to use VoiceOver, press the space bar now.
Okay. So this is about natural clothing, how natural clothing, natural fabrics and natural dyeing is important in our day-to-day clothing that we wear. Yes. So now we have always heard that, you know, how fashion industry is affecting our health and environment, how it is changing how we choose our clothes and how we, you know, try to choose what we wear on everyday basis. So we have heard about this term called fast fashion. Now, what is this fast fashion? Why is there is a term called fast fashion? Why there is a term also called slow fashion? So what is the difference between fast fashion and slow fashion? Why there is a specific term called fast fashion? So we'll understand the terminology of it. The term fast fashion has become more prominent in conversation because it refers to cheaply produced and cheaply priced garments. Now, every brand that you see out in market, they are all having all kinds of discounts. Like even if the new collection is launched, there are so many discounts going on. Why? Because it is cheaply made, and that is why it is very cheaply available. And also the other thing is that we as a consumer, we also believe that, okay, I have worn this dress once, why should I wear it again? So this is the thought process that we have developed over the years as a human being. And every time there is something, always we are looking for something new. So why do we have that thought? And when we look back to our forefathers and our grandparents, they never had this kind of thought process that I will not wear this sari because I've already worn it somewhere else. So why is it changing? Because we are getting all the clothes very cheap. Now, but since we are getting all the clothes cheap, is it really made cheap, or how, you know, why it is in terms of environmental effects, why it is bad? I totally get it that you would be thinking that how cheap clothes and environmental effects and climate change is related. So I'll show you that how climate change, environmental effects of fast fashion is related to how we as consumers choose to buy things. Now, why fast fashion is bad? Here are some facts that I would share. Now, every fifth garment produced is never worn. This means that there are five garments made at a time, and the only out of which two or three would be sold, one would be worn, rest all the four pieces are going to be dumped. Now, if you see, this equals 1 billion unworn garments. If you include rarely worn items, you get 2 billion wardrobe corpses. This means that you get 2 billion number of clothes piled up in a dump. Now, where are these going? Why it is happening like this? Since our trend on Instagram and trend on internet is continuously changing, we have OOT. This means that outfit of the day. This means that today, if I'm wearing something, I won't wear the same t-shirt or same dress or same pant tomorrow. So with this mentality, this is the landfill rate that we are going ahead with. Now, next is that fast fashion makes shopping for clothes more affordable. Now it comes at very cheap rate that, you know, anybody can afford bigger brands. Now, if you say that why we are able to afford Levi's jeans, because they are coming, they have reduced their prices. Why they have reduced the prices? Because we as a consumer have asked for reducing the prices. Now, if they want to reduce the prices, they'll reduce the cost of making their garment. Now, reducing the cost of making the garment means that they'll compromise on the quality of garment, compromise on the material use, compromise on dyeing, compromise on paying salaries to their employees, compromise in all terms. That is why it is bad for the environment, for our health, and for the economy also. Now, here is another fact. The fashion industry produces 10% of all humanity's carbon emissions and is the second largest consumer of world's water supply and pollutes oceans with microplastics. Now, coming to a new topic, saying that it is the second largest pollutant on earth. This means that, you know, our clothes that we wear are made in such a way that it is polluting the environment, and it is ranked at the second in the world. Just imagine the amount of waste we are generating, and brands are generating just to make those cheap garments. Now, next is 85% of all textiles go to dump each year. Now, some types of clothes send thousands of microplastics into the ocean. Now, every time you would be wondering how are we sending microplastics to oceans? Now, every time you wash our clothes, specifically polyester made clothes, if you wash them, there are certain micro particles that would be detached from the fibers. You know, the fibers, when they are vigorously rubbed, they will detach certain elements from it, and those are very tiny. We can't even see in microscope. Those are so tiny that we can't even, you know, try to find out that how damaging it is. Now, that water, after washing our clothes, goes to all our river streams or our and it directly goes to ocean. Now, this indirectly affects the ocean's ecosystem, because the fishes and the marine life is affected through that. So these all things are so correlated to each other. Now, according to Ethical Consumer and Greenpeace Journal Unearth, if the demand for fast fashion continues to grow at its current rate, we could see the total carbon footprint of our clothing reach by 26% by 2050. Now, in just 30 years, we can almost double, or we can reach three times of the demand that we have right now. And the carbon footprint is enormously increasing every day. Now, what other factors that are, you know, related to this? Now, washing clothes, as I mentioned, that releases microplastics and microfibers that pollute the environment. Now, how much pollution it is creating? That is equivalent to 50 million plastic bottles. Just imagine 50 million plastic bottles of Bisleri being dumped in ocean at once in a year. So this is the amount of pollution that is being generated through all this fast fashion clothes. I mean, specifically saying polyester made clothes. Now, next is many of those fibers are polyester, a plastic found in an estimated 60% of the garments. Now, when I say polyester, all of our garments that we are wearing today in day-to-day life, for example, say polycotton. Now, polycotton is not cotton, it is polyester plus cotton. So there is amount of polyester in that fabric. Now, every type of fabric that we see today, man-made fibers, are all made out of polyester. There is a certain amount, a certain percentage of polyester in each garment that we are wearing today. Now, this is how it is affecting our environment, plus it also affects our skin. Now, producing polyester releases 2 to 3 times more carbon than cotton, and polyester does not break down in ocean. Now, compared to cotton, when we compare polyester and cotton, it releases 3 times carbon, and it is not even decomposable. Now, if I say that cotton, generating cotton, and you know, cotton agriculture requires so much of water, but at the end of the day, the cotton, if you put it in soil, it will at least decompose. Polyester won't decompose. It takes 2,500 years to decompose in soil, and there will be still parts of it found if you dig it after those years. Another point is harmful. It is harmful for our skin and has long-term health issues. Now, you must have heard about a chemical called formaldehyde. Now, formaldehyde is used to treat ready garments. Once the garments are being made, they are dipped in formaldehyde liquid so that your garment is, you know, it looks new, it is very crisp, and you don't even need to iron it. You can just wear it, you can just pull it from the shop and wear it as it is. Now, formaldehyde reacts with your skin, and people with sensitive skin have a lot of side effects, and there have been a lot of petitions to avoid formaldehyde during garment production. So now they have reduced, and a lot of have taken steps to reduce using formaldehyde during the garment production. Now you would ask, what can we do about this? What should we do? What we as a consumer should be doing to change this fact? Now, I would just like to briefly tell this, because other panelists have already explained us the importance of natural dye. So I'll just try to make it as crisp as possible. So first is choose organic fibers and natural fibers that do not require chemicals to be produced. Now, in terms of organic fibers and natural fibers, when we say organic fibers and natural fibers, we mean fibers that are made from plants and living organisms that can be reused or repurposed or, you know, regenerated. For example, growing cotton is a regenerative process. You can grow cotton as many times as you want. You can have silk as many times as you want. So these are the types of fibers that you should be choosing while making a purchase. Next that we all can do is buy less and buy better quality. Now, as the prices of the clothes go down, the quality of the product also is affected, right? Who will give a good quality product at 200 rupees? Because of course, if you're paying 200 rupees, you will get that kind of a quality. So always ask for good quality. Of course, the good quality products would be a little expensive, but it will last long and it will be very good for the environment. Second is choose handmade. Now, why I'm saying choose handmade is because most of the natural fibers and organic fibers are all hand grown and hand spun and hand woven. Throughout the history, if you check our history, all the natural fibers have been used in our clothing. So this is a point that I would mention, that choose handmade. And next is choose natural dyed clothing. Now, choosing natural dyed clothing also affects a lot to our health in terms of skin diseases and in terms of environmental effects. Now, natural dyed clothing is made 100% from, you know, roots and leaves and all kinds of herbs. So there is no side effect of that kind of dyeing to environment. Plus, there are so many healing properties of those herbs and dyes that we have already discussed. So moving on to the next point. Now, what are natural and handmade fabrics? So some of the natural and handmade fabrics that I have listed here are linen. So linen is derived from flax plant, cotton, as we all know, hemp. Hemp is also a very good natural fibers, and that has recently taken up the eyes of designers and people who are trying to change fast fashion scenario. Another one is silk. Then we have Kashmir. Kashmir is a wool derived from goats, specifically from northern parts of India. Then there is a different kind of wool that can be derived from different kinds of sheep and goats. And next is jute. Another one is bamboo. Now, bamboo is also one of the a very recently found plant fiber, but it is one of the softest, breathable and durable material that is available right now in terms of choosing natural fibers. Next is, what are the advantages of these natural fibers? Now, these are eco-friendly. That means it is good for you and environment. There is no side effect with all these natural fibers that we discussed. Next is, the majority of these fabrics are biodegradable. That means you don't have to worry about the waste that is and the pollution that is being generated in the environment. Next is, they have all of the above listed fibers have moisture wicking properties. That means they absorb your sweat, they absorb the moisture, and they will keep you dry and fuss free. Now, next is breathable. Now, everybody knows that why we choose cotton over other fibers, because a lot of people, you would have seen that choosing only cotton fabrics because they are breathable and they are, it is the best material that is available for all kinds of tropical climate. India falls under tropical climatic conditions, and in India, we should specifically focus only on cotton because it is the most breathable and moisture wicking fabric that is available. Now, next point is, they are durable, heat responsive and naturally repellent to mud and dirt. A lot of fibers, for example, hemp and bamboo, are repellent to dirt and mud. So, and also they are repellent to a lot of other heat generating materials. So these are some of the advantages of natural fibers. Another one is high absorption qualities in natural textiles. Now, as I mentioned, that it absorbs sweat more quickly than any polyester made garment would absorb your sweat. So this is, you know, it gives a lot of options as a natural fiber for us to make not just clothes, but any kind of material or any kind of products that we want. Natural fibers are used in home linen and a lot of different medicinal purposes as well. So why not use these properties of natural fabrics and, you know, turn them into something really nice and revolutionary. Now, specifically talking about linen, silk and cotton, they are naturally hypoallergenic. This means that they also have unique antibacterial qualities, therefore making them ideal for sensitive and allergy prone skin. Now, hypoallergenic, I might not know the medical and scientific term and effects of and knowledge about hypoallergenic, but what I understand is these fibers are very ideal for allergy prone skin. If somebody is prone to any kind of skin allergies, they should only prefer linen and silk and if possible cotton. So these are some of the medicinal properties that we can see in these natural textiles. Next is natural and herbal dyeing. How these natural and herbal dyeing are important and how it is derived, what are the materials used, I'll briefly take you through that. So these are some visual representations of what are the dye stuff that can be used. So materials like leaves, flowers, herbs, seeds and mud are used as colorants for obtaining different shades. So for the first image that you see is indigo leaves. So indigo leaves, the dyeing process is really amazing, that you have to ferment the indigo leaves and then, you know, you get different it works on oxidation process. So you get a green colored dye, and then when you dip the fabric and take it out, it turns into blue. So and talking about indigo has a lot of medicinal uses other than just giving it a natural blue color. Now, next is madder. As we know, manchester. Manchester is also used for dyeing purposes, and we get beautiful reds from it. Now, we also use pomegranate skins to derive this kind of yellow ochre shades. And we use marigold to give bright yellow colors. So all these materials are naturally available and this can be easily used. And as previously in the first presentation, we saw that how these natural dyes are, you know, available in nature and how to use them. So there is a huge chemistry behind it and we can easily, you know, use them with our natural fibers. Now, dyes, particularly natural dyes, have held untold importance in our lives for thousands of years, providing not only aesthetic satisfaction, but also utilitarian uses as well. The oldest and most widely used dye is indigo, and indigo has a lot of history with India. So natural dyes are dyes or colorants derived from plants, animals, and minerals. Now, next. Now, chemicals, toxic dyes, and pesticides are the dyes that are used right now for all kinds of apparel production, and are directly in contact with our skin. So these kinds of chemicals, when, you know, after varied use of it, and, you know, they don't just go out of the fabric, they remain in the fabric after every use. They react differently with our detergents and provide and give a different kind of chemicals, which will in turn create cancer, asthma, and allergies in our body. So with natural dyes, it's so easy to keep away from all those chemicals and, you know, have a safe and be safe and healthy. So this is my presentation, and I would just like to take you through a short video of what we at Organic Symmetry have done for all the consumers out there to understand that how, you know, it is important to choose natural clothing. Can you hear?
Solar jazz. It's as different. You want it all. You want it now. Doesn't matter from where. Doesn't matter how. Shop till you drop. Haul after haul. So fast. It leaves Mother Earth a ball. Sprees end up in a dump. And our surroundings in a slum. It's time we slow down the fashion. To slow down the destruction. It's time to rethink. Make conscious choices, more than a fashion statement, and rise to the slow fashion movement. This is all needed. Let's be the start of something new, ethical.
So this is what we have done. We are doing at my brand called Organic Symmetry. This was a small representation of it. And then moving back again to the presentation. Yes. So yes, let's strive to be conscious in our clothing choices and keep the earth how we found it and generate less waste. This is, as a apparel designer, I would want it to, you know, showcase in terms of how choosing organic clothing, natural clothing, can save us from a lot of health issues and also environmental issues. Thank you so much for giving me this space and opportunity to share this with you all.
Thank you, madam. It was really a wonderful presentation. We came to know a lot, and we wish best for your projects. Now, moving on. We are getting very good comments also in our comment box. We'll go to the question answer and discussion round in the end of the session after listening to the all speakers. Yes. We have two more speakers with us. And our next speaker is Mr. Thanga Kumar, sir. Sir is from Thiruvananthapuram, Kerala. Sir is a Ayurvastra dyeing expert. He is a certified natural dyer of Kairali Exports. Sir, Thanga Kumar ji.
Yeah, you are hearing me, sir?
Yeah, yeah, you are audible. Yes, sir. Sir, you can start your presentation.
Thank you.
Yeah, welcome, okay. Sir.
Yes, sir, thank you. Actually, we have been 63 years in the industry of handloom. And today, to my farm to celebrate the handloom day and the similar weekend. So I will try to explain as far as possible to share my small presentation, where I will explain detail about our Ayurvedic textile. So our company started in 1963, and explain detail about the Ayurvedic textile now.
There seems to be some network issues. Thanga Kumar sir, can you switch off your video and continue?
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir, you can switch.
I will share your presentation. Don't worry. Please switch off your video.
Okay, thank you.
I am sharing your presentation.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you. Okay, sir. Now I will. Thank you very much, sir. So now I'm going to, because now the world is moving to Ayurvastra. Even I found the, you are hearing me now, sir? I'm audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
It's audible. It's audible. Only little network issue. Sir, you can switch off your video now. In the end of the session, yeah, okay, it's fine. Now please continue.
Okay, sir. So, for past 15 years, we have been working in this Ayurvedic textile. So what I want to tell you is that, please you go to the next screen. I will tell you what is the world now facing. Okay, sir. The entire world is now facing so many issues. All the, even the humans, the organism in the earth, the living things in the earth, everything is facing problem. Like, for example, climate change is there. And our forest is becoming very less. And the food production, the water scarcity, all is becoming more and more. So we are deviating our from the nature. So what is the solution is, because the fourth thing is very important. As per our concept, we should have the climate change. You can see the slide, the climate change, deforestation, water shortage, depleting of agricultural lands, and increase of disease. Now the people are facing a lot of diseases. So why this disease is happening is the water system is collapsed. Because before 100 years, before the invention of the synthetic dye, everything was naturally done. People using natural means of cultivation. They were using native seeds. And even in textiles, they were using natural things. So the whole earth was balancing itself. So but after this invention of the synthetic dye, 100 years after that, there was a big collision in the pollution of water. Once the water is polluted, you get the it is not the right water is there, then you get all kind of diseases. For example, in textile, we are, the synthetic people, they are using a wet agent for wetting the fabric. It is having high viscosity. So after that wetting, they are letting this into the water. What happens? The fish is dying because it is not able to breathe of the viscosity. Then when the fish is dying, what grows is the mosquito and all the disease microorganism which is spreading. So that is the major part. In one part, a textile, they are using some kind of chemical and it is changing the biological environment. So creating a lot of, even 85% of our water is now not drinkable, or it has been polluted throughout the world in this 100 years of use of synthetic dyes. Okay, now I'm going to before 100 years how we have died. So before 100 years, our people are very health conscious people. And in India, you know, we are very much like a university for the entire world. For example, Handloom Day celebration. Now you are seeing the hand, which one lady speaker, you were speaking very nicely about the handlooms. Okay, so now we come back. So what happens in India, it's a golden age. People, now they are thinking India is a something very differently. But in my own experience, I have studied a lot, and India is the university for the entire. For example, the philosophy is the philosophy is one. The human body is made with Panchabhuta. Everybody know, most probably every Indian, because in background of Ayurveda know. Then we work using Panchayendra. Okay, the skin is the very big organ in our body, which covers the vital organ. Now, you are going to wear a textile, which is going to cover your entire body. And if the textile is toxic and if it is dyed with chemical, what will happen to your skin? That you have to think about that. So now in 1996, there was a research in Germany, and they found most of the skin cancer is because of the dye stuff in the fabric. After that, there was a big awareness. But before 2000 years, our people, they understood our body anatomy, and they were using herb for the dyeing. They were using the natural. So the same thing we studied, we have made a lot of research, we have made clinical trial. Then we want to replace the toxic synthetic dye from the natural source, 100%. Not like putting some modern, because I was listening to a speaker, doctor, I think is the first speaker, who told about that natural dyeing is having some kind of modern and it is not that much good like that. Yeah, I agree with him. So when you say about the conventional natural dyeing, they are adding some kind of modern, which is synthetic. But in Ayurvedic, the focus is very important. Our focus is for the wellness. We should not add any kind of modern or synthetic in our process. That is our objective. And we are very successful now. We are, what is the concept? So these five yendra, skin is a major thing. So skin can be a mediator. Cloth can be a mediator to transform the goodness of the herb into the body. So that is our idea. So Ayurvastra is more than a natural textile. And we dye the, we have 12 shades. We have 12 shades, like from turmeric to black we have. Okay, I will go by the slide, sorry. Okay, please go to the first slide. Yeah. Okay, now textile and skin. I have explained about that using Ayurveda. You go to the next screen, sir. Yeah, please go to the next screen. I will explain. Okay. Organism include that I already told you about the Panchabhuta and Panchayendra. So this is the anatomy of Indian physician. So Ayurveda people also agree with that. Okay, you can go to the next slide, sir. Okay. So here, Ayurvedic textiles are textiles made. We are using only natural fiber. We cannot do with synthetic fiber like rayon. So cotton, linen, silk wire only we use. And it is dyed with medicinal rich herbs for making shirts and give wellness property. This is where our formula is there. For example, Tripala, you know, it's a three dosha option. So Tripala is a thing they are taking internally. So when they take internally, it is claimed that it can cure, it can balance your doshas. So what we apply, we dye in the cloth. And it is giving a nice yellow color. It is like a light yellow and brown shade. So it will come. And when the people, when even a baby or a bigger people, they regularly, they try to wear it, it can leach through your skin. So many people, they doubt how it will go to the skin. And we have a very positive feedback. For example, we have a sleep enhancing bedsheet. We dye with herb and we make bedsheet. Because sleep is very important. But now what people are sleeping in a synthetic foam and it will generate heat, it will not give you a proper sleep. So what we do, we dye with a pure cotton with herb. For example, even Tripala also, it is not having any toxic. Now what they do, 8 hours long, the people are lying in the cloth, which is dyed with herbs. So the skin is having a property to absorb in. If there is a heat environment, sweat is coming. If your mosquito is biting, it is taking blood from your skin. And it through the small nose, it is penetrate and it takes the blood. So what is the meaning is that you have opening. So then the blood vessel is very near. And you have already, you have a cloth which is dyed with the pure herb, medicinal rich Ayurvedic herb. What it happens, it carries the dyes or some goodness. So what happens, the skin can absorb a good thing. Maybe it will give some kind of immunization and some kind of good feeling, because it is natural. Skin is also natural. You may get a nice sleep. So we are promoting like that. So many people who buy our bedsheet, they change. They say they are very sleeping very well, and they are not liking any synthetic. Even if it is very costly, also they are not liking. So our bedsheet is very popular in US also. Okay, the next slide, please. So in technically, I will tell you what we are doing. So in Ayurvedic textile price, we do desizing, which is because in while they are doing the fabric, they will apply some wax, some kind of material for the weaving purpose. They want to do it in the warping and weaving. They apply some gum, starch, etc. So desizing in synthetic also, they use a wet agent. So wet agent is a chemical, but what we do, we are using a Rita. It's called a soap net in English. So it is even you can wash your cloth with Rita. It is coming from a tree, and in 2000 years before, people are using for so many purpose. Okay, then we are going for the, after the desizing, we are going for the scouring, then we are going for bleaching, then the kashayam preparation. Here where we integrate the herbs, the natural modern, which is so many natural modern, the fixing is there. Myrobalam is one, and you have alum also, natural alum. It is not industrial. So we are using some everything. We are preparing kashayam. More than 15 herbs will be in the kashayam. Then after that, hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello, sir.
Yes, hello.
Sorry, sir. Actually, yes, sir. So now my other, so I'm continuing, sir. Okay, you are audible, sir. You are listening?
Yeah. It's audible. Yeah, okay. Please continue.
Yeah, sir. Thank you, sir. Now, so these are, then after that, we are using pre-modernting, which is also natural. Then we are dyeing it. Then we are finishing it. Then we are softening it. So all the process is using, softening is done by applying coconut oil, castor oil only. Then I said the desizing, how we are doing, we are showing in the screen. You can go with other screens, sir. Yeah, desizing. This is the Rita, which we are using for the desizing. It is a one material. Even anybody can use this for washing. There is no, because I want to tell you another point. See, there are about 200 crore of people all around the world. Every day they are using surf. They are using some kind of high bleaching detergent, and they are putting in the ground. You see how much of pollution they are making. You see a lot of advertisement, Ariel, and so many branded. So all are synthetic, and that will go into the groundwater. It will pollute more than like that. So it is our people, our forefathers, our rishis, they were using this Rita only. That is it is called soap net. So this is a very good washing. And then the scouring is done. We are using earlier we were using Komutra, the cow urine, which is having uric acid. But now, because even the native cow is not available, because everything was industrialized and the cow is becoming now Jersey cows. And so we don't want to take that. So now we are taking ash water for that. We are using as an alkali, as an ash water for the scouring. Because now what I want to tell you another point, the scouring in synthetic dye, what they do a tons of called plastics and so many things, which is very polluting the water. We are using only the ash water, okay, for removing the RFD. We are making the RFD. You can go to the next slide, sir. Okay, so this I told about, we are not calling as a dyes, we are calling as a kashayam, because we are putting, for example, I told you Tripala. Tripala will be for the wellness aspect. And for coloring aspect, we can add turmeric, we can add madder, we can add so many colorant, Ratta Chandan, or you said red sandal, or Manjista, or maybe even you have good color in Karsilangani, that Bringraj. So color one part, then modern to another part, and another part is the Ayurvedic part. So we have, that is for the wellness part. So we have a formula which we derive how to fix it. We have only 12 colors. We make only 12 colors, and in 12 colors we have standardized. In every color we will be adding some kind of Ayurvedic herb, some group of Ayurvedic herb, because we want to make the fabric into some kind of energy. That is our objective. It is not for a simple dye. And I have told many people was talking about fastness. Our dyes is not for fastness. Even there will be a color variation
that professor initially was talking about so many good things that there will be color variation. Absolutely, all natural will have color variations because different plants grow here and different soil. So color variation is natural only. Our customers, they love to wear our fabric, buy to wear our fabric, even though there is no color fastness. So our focus is not color fastness. Our focus is that our earth should be preserved and the cloth should be, that's all. So it is to be toxic free. That is our objective. So kashayam is our formula. And it is conventional natural dyeing. They just put one color and they say it is natural dyeing. We don't never put any one color. We mix with color, modern, natural wellness aspect. Even we add aloe vera and we add neem. It is having antimicrobial property. So we know where to add. We, in respect of acidic, what it is, alkali, what it is, how to mix it, whether it is a ripple, all we have studied and we have made it. Okay. So now one person is making the kashayam. We have the different type of herbs. We add it in a different formula, standardized formula. We make that. Next, sir. Okay. So this is now you are seeing it's a sampling only. It's a turmeric dyed. And it is because, you know, turmeric is it's a poor dye. Actually, people will say it's a poor dye because it react with alkali. When you put soap, it will become red. But it is, if they are continuously wearing it, they will, even that can be, they can better. Because we are using the cloth only. It is not, we are not taking any internal medicine. Along with the internal medicine, if you wear our Ayurvedic textile, it will give a tremendous result, which has been proved in Ayurveda College, Thiruvananthapuram, where there was a study in Ayurveda College, and you can, that paper is also there. So this gives comfort to our skin because of, nature is very close to our skin. The skin is having affinity to the natural textiles. So what happens, many of the patients are immediately recovered when they are using Ayurvedic environment and Ayurvedic cloth. And people who are in other type of, wearing other type of cloth, they took long time rather than the Ayurvedic people. And most of the skin disease, it is fastly recovered when they are wearing our Ayurvedic. It has been proved. There was a clinical trial done in Ayurvedic College in Kerala. Okay. Yeah. So you are seeing the process, how we are making. Now, these are the manually we are making. Now we have mechanized it. And we are making a very nice product, mostly bed sheets, towels, handloom towel, because we are giving more importance to handloom industry because it is a second industry than our agriculture. Next to agriculture in India, we have all handloom in every village. There will be a farmer community, there will be a weaver community, and we have been balancing like anything in a, we lived in harmony. But now because of so much of that, what it is not a proper development, no proper improper planning, and it is centralization of our things. We lost our balancing life because village life was very much integrated. They have one farmer community who will doing farming, one weaving community will be there, one temple will be there, lake will be there. So now everything has been dismantled and we are into a different situation in India. So we are very much interested to take it back to our ancient thing where we have a very good process. One is textile. Okay. Then we do natural finishing. This color, which we took from Padimugam, it is called Sapanwood. It gives a very bright, because this, when you see this, it looks like a synthetic dye, but we have taken it in using Padimugam. Okay. It's that kind of bright colors we can take from Padimugam. Then we are using oils for finishing it. And there we are also using some seasoning, because if you put the cloth in some dark environment, the color fastness will be good. Okay. Then we have to shade it. So I will tell about the products which we are taking. The best is the human has to have a nice sleep. So what we do is we are having bedding as a major product. And most probably we have exported to US, and now there is a good demand of our bed sheet. People are asking Ayurvastra everywhere. Even our previous speaker is talking about Ayurvastra. So the real Ayurvastra is that it is not a real natural dyeing. We have to put our energy into the fabric. Then only we can call as an Ayurvastra. So from 1963, then because it is having a law, it is having a big history also, that I have less time, so I cannot tell that. So bedsheet is very important. Then we have towels we are making in handloom. Then we are making innerwear because it is touching our vital organism. Once they use our innerwear, they will never change it to any synthetic innerwear also. That much of affinity people are having. Our products, things are growing. We have a very good market, and now we have a sufficient order, and people are now satisfied with our Ayurvastra. And thanks for the entire team for giving me an opportunity for presenting it. Because I came to my farm and my dyeing industry, I'm not able to have that proper thing, but everything is okay. Thank you very much. Thank you, our moderator and host, and the entire Sharmaji, and for our entire team who have made this opportunity for us. Thank you very much, sir.
Excellent, excellent, Mr. Thanga. Excellent. No doubt you have compiled. You are a practical person, so excellent.
Yes, sir.
Kailash.
Yeah, yeah.
Huh. Thank you, Thanga, sir, and Kairali Exports. Really, the program is getting interesting from modern to classical view. We are exploring the natural clothes with herbal touch. Moving on to our next speaker of the day, Dr. Mrs. Dipali Devi. She is from Guwahati, Assam. She is a senior scientist in SERI Biotech Unit, Institute of Advanced Study in Science and Technology, Guwahati. Madam?
Yes. Yes, I am
here. Yeah. Let me give a short brief also. Madam, have done area of research of Madam is insect biology, biotechnology, silk fiber technology, and silk as biomaterials. She has postdoctorate and she has silk as biomaterials at Deakin University, Australia in 2013 and 14, silkworm biochemistry at Padova University, Padova, Italy 2005 to 2006, silk fiber technology at Milano, Italy, and insect molecular biology science at Bangalore, India. She has PhD in insect biochemistry from Guwahati University, MSc in zoology from Guwahati University. She has been associate professor, assistant professor, lecturer, research scientist, and lots of credits to her. She has supervised more than 15 students in PhD. She has undergoing 11 and more research projects. She has more than 70 publications. 3 number of patents have been applied. She have lots of achievements and book publications also. She have attended many conferences and workshops of national and international repute. So without taking more time, let me welcome Madam to today's program, where she will be delivering her speech on the topic, Silk, the Queen of Textile. Welcome. Welcome, ma'am. The dais is yours.
Thank you very much for giving my introduction so nicely. So first of all, I thank all the organizers and for giving me the opportunities to be a part of this meeting conference. So and again, I thank all the organizers and all the panelists present here, and very good afternoon to all of you. So at the beginning, I want to show a very little clipping. Just a moment.
Yes, madam, it is said, but the screen is, we are not able to see anything in the screen.
Just a moment.
Madam, you keep the presentation open, then you share the screen.
So, can I skip this one? Or
yes, first stop sharing.
Yeah, yeah. So,
stop sharing, then again sharing.
Okay.
Before sharing, open that PowerPoint in your computer.
उसको ले लेना है।
Yes, it's visual, madam.
Okay. So we are here for celebrating the National Handloom Day. So this is a very familiar scenario in all over India, as we all of us witnessed from our childhood. So I would like to salute all the artisans and weavers on this auspicious day. I would like to salute them for their continuous efforts for making this continuous process in India. So I'll go to the next slide. So today is the National Handloom Day, 7th August 2021, and theme of this day is Handloom and Indian Legacy, because as handloom has been the pride of India's traditional and culture. Today is observed annually to create awareness about handloom industry among the public at large and its contribution to the socio-economic development. Also to highlight the handloom trade in India. Handloom sector depicts the Indian glorious culture, heritage, and important source of the livelihood for mostly poorer section of the people. Since the 70% of handloom weaver and allied works are women, it acts as a key to women empowerment. For Indian context, it is very much important because it is act as a key to women empowerment. The need for awareness, accessibility to markets and design, R&D, easy access to raw material and better credit support can make a difference to weavers in different corners of the country. And then we can truly create a national handloom, celebrate a National Handloom Day, because we know that still that handloom sector is a cottage, very limited sector in India. Although handloom in India is the second earning source after the agriculture, nearing 43 lakhs people has been engaged in handloom sector, and almost 15% of total clothing is coming from handloom. 95% of total handloom product of world is shared by India. Handloom is an age-old technique which has been depicted in history 3,000 years back. It is also mentioned in the Mohenjo-Daro civilization. Based on the construction and operational technique, the loom can be categorized into primitive subtle thread loom, body loom, frame loom, pit loom, and semi-automatic loom, etc. All these are in the part of handloom. So natural fibers used in handlooms are categorized in two divisions, and it is like some of them are from plant-based, and those are cotton, jute, rami, bamboo, banana, flax, hemp, cord, sisal, etc. And some are from animal-based. All those are wool, and it is comprised of alpaca, angora, camel, cashmere, and some insect secreting. Those are silk. So today my talk will be on the silk. It will be especially, I will talk something about the silk. Already we have so many talks on different aspects of handloom and the natural dyes, and also the Ayurveda Vastra. Those are very fascinating. And one of the products that has been used throughout the handloom and that is the silk. And also it is the known as the queen of textile from long back, because it is very pure, very serene, and it has been used to adorn the all deities in our temple, and also we use in the festival and also the wedding ceremony, etc., etc. That is how it is known as the queen of textile. These are some picture I have put here. So this is the silkworm. It produces the, it weave the cocoon for their shelter. But as a human being, we exploit this cocoon for our own self, for our garments. So I am showing here all these products from this silkworm. This is a muga silkworm, and this is muga fabrics, and this is a muga folding, that is a blanket. Those are some fiber from muga silk. So we should know, because what is silk? So it is very important to know that what is silk. So silk fibers produced by silkworms are nature's most highly engineered nature structural material, and have a good combination of strength and toughness, which is these two the characters is very important in for the handloom sectors, and that cannot be reproduced by artificial means. And again, nearly 400 to 500 species of silkworms are shown to produce silk. The majority of the silk producing insects belonging to the order Lepidoptera and families Bombycidae or Saponidae. Then nearly 95% of commercial insect silk come from the mulberry silkworm, which we know as the pat silk, and the rest are from all other sources collectively called non-mulberry silk, and it includes muga, eri, and tropical tassar. So silk from different species are composed of proteins of particular primary structure, that is amino acids, and leading to amino acids are glycine, alanine, and serine. Actually, these three are the main component of the protein, that is silk. And in the arrangement of these three, it differs in the various silkworms, and that is why the structure of silk comes in. Why silk? Silk means style and luxury to the wearer, whereas it simply means survival for the rearer, reeler, spinner, and weavers. I will show one picture where the all these are known, that internally they are interlinked. So silk is royal in its splendor, exotic and sensual in its radiance, spectacular in fashion. This is also very important. That is why it is called queen of the fabric, textile. No other fabrics draft so beautifully with optimal weather comforts. Silk, a valued gift of nature, is a precious commodity once bartered against gold. So it is something like gold. While the wearer is mostly the affluent strata of the society, ironically, silk is produced by underprivileged, rural, poor, and weaker section of the society. That is why it is need to take very much utmost care to develop the handloom sector and the silk industry to for the upliftment of the poor section of the people. Then silk is bringing a silent revolution, acting as an agent of socialism by enabling money to flow from the hands of the rich to the poor. It is also important because as it is produced by the poorer section of the people, so and wearers are users are very highly affluent strata of the society. So it is, it makes some revolution for making changing the money chain. So I'm showing here some silk producing insects, and these are the databases. There are so many data that they are showing the silk, how they produce, why they produce. So these are spider, they are producing silk for preying. This silkworm cocoon, they are for their shelter, they produce this cocoon. The pupa remain inside in safe condition, and this is, you can say this is a house for them. And this is a scorpion, they for prayer also, then they produce silk. Then whalemen mite, they stick their eggs And this is a cattle flies. They also produce silk and they keep their eggs there. This is egg of lacewarm. They keep this eggs, no, for protection. They in the down part of the leaves, they put their eggs hanging like this. So these are all silk. And other silk producing organisms are honeybee, raspy crickets, weaver ants. So many insects are there, but silk producing insects are there. But commercially silk are used from the cocoon of silkworm. So the commercial silk, it is coming from two major sectors. This is a mulberry silk and this is non-mulberry silk. This mulberry silk, they thrives only on mulberry plants, but all other non-mulberry silkworm, they thrives on other food plants. That is why this part is non-mulberry silk. So we have muga silk, eri silk, and tassar. Those are commercially exploited silkworm. So I'm showing here that from soil to silk, a long distance to go from soil. It has started from the soil, and the whole silkworm industry is an agro-based industry. So it starts from soil and it gives the silk. So it is a long process, and so many people are engaged in this sector, from soil to make the soil to silk. So some landlords are there, then planters who plant the food plants, then rearers, they rear the silkworm, then reelers and spinners, they reel the silk, then weavers, these reelers, and they are the people who make the textile and garments, and then traders, they make the trade, then entrepreneurs, then technologies have a big role, how to make the silk very highly engineered, then how the silk make comfortable to use. So technologies, they do all those things. Then scientists, they do the scientific study or scientific part. So all these people are engaged in the sericulture sector. So I'm showing here the life cycle of a silkworm. It is a muga silkworm, life cycle of a muga silkworm, but it is true for all other silkworms, the same cycle. So adult worms, then it gives the egg, then 5 instant larval growth, then they make the cocoon. And this is pupa. It is a life condition. From this pupa, they come to the moth portion, and they make the, again, the, it is going to the cycle. But this part is the human intervention is here. So they kill this cocoon and they take out the silk from here and they make the fiber, and then the goes for textile. So I'm just showing the how the silk gland grows from first instar to 5th instar. It is in first instar, it is very low. The silk is not produced from here, but this is the silk gland that it throws the silk from the mouth, and it comes out as a silk thread. So silk, basically silk are protein. So it is a symmetric diagram. So this is spinneret. They spin they throw the silk from here. And this is a gland. There are two glands along the digestive system. And this is the anterior part, this is middle part, and the posterior part. Posterior part, they produce the silk fibron. Then this part only they store the silk, and this part they throw the silk from here through the spinneret to the outer section. And this is a symmetric diagram that there are twin structure of a fiber, because there are two silk glands. So twin structure and the alignment of all amino acids, it is lies there. And the other part, it is a sericin part, that is water soluble protein that is not used in textile. Only this core portion it used in formation of fiber, and it comes in the textile. And when we remove this sericin, then again it is another another work that the senescin has to be removed from here. It is a process and some chemical used in this process. But while we are talking about the Ayurveda or the natural silk, then we can remove this senescin without using the chemicals. So it is a scientific study already done, and it has been used the hot water or hot bath to remove this senescin. And again, that senescin we can use for coating another fiber like cotton, jute. We can make this waste senescin protein to coating the other silk to make them again the natural natural fiber. Then in general, silk cocoons are composed of a fibrous protein, fiber core, and a surrounding glue protein. Glue proteins are water soluble, but fibrous proteins are not water soluble. Fibrin is the major structural protein secreted from the posterior silk gland, and sericin is synthesized in the medial silk gland of the mature silkworm larva. And during spinning, the fibrin from PSG gets coated with the sericin from the medial silk gland. And again, it throws through the spinneret to the outside. And when it comes to the contact with the air, it gets hard and it becomes the fiber. So it is very natural. It does not have any chemicals itself, but when people make it process, then sometimes it used some chemicals, but without chemicals also it can be done, that the sericin can be removed without using chemicals, then it will be 100% natural. So I'm showing here some product. Those are from handmade, that handloom product. And from this, again, some people later use some other diversified product like ornaments. And nowadays, some sericin and fibrin, it has been dissolved and it has been are using in the cosmetic also. It is not relevant to the handloom or fabric, but it is also important that silk can be used in natural Ayurveda, in natural condition, in cosmetics. And again, some upholstery and some other items also could be made out of silk. And one more thing, already it has been discussed, that natural dyeing on silk, that is very important and very congenial for health also. As it has been discussed earlier, 3-4 speakers, so I will not elaborate that part. But I am talking about the silk as a whole, but Muga silk, that Antheria acemensis, produced by the Antheria acemensis, that is indigenous to the northeastern part only. And it is highly valued, and in the value is more because the production is less, and the tensile strength is more, UV absorption capacity is more in Muga silkworm. That is why the price is very high. The durability it cannot be matched with other silk. And Bombyx mori silk is used globally because it is available in many other parts also. And talking about non-mulberry silk, that is Muga and Eri, that is a very in case of Eri, it has some thermal absorption capacity, so that is what people use for winter clothing also, and also inner linen. Does Eri, and Eri cost is very less, that and availability is more. That is why Eri can be used in various ways, but Muga is using in traditional dress material, and then sarees also, and it has been exported to Japan, and in mostly in Japan for preparing the kimono and their traditional dresses. So it is very, very important to make the natural clothing. And Muga cannot be dyed. That is another aspect for Muga. Muga silk already, it has the pigment, and it is identified as the isoeugenol, that is coming from the food plants itself. The footprints is different. So isomethyl Eugenol is present in the muga, that is why it necessarily golden color. So that is why muga is called the natural queen of other silk also. So I am showing here some silk biomaterial, because there are nowadays there are so many scientific studies are going on for silk as a biomaterial, because it can be used as suture material, then powder material for cosmetics, and then some scaffold for the skin treatment, and many more things that those are coming up. Then in conclusion, I am saying that silk is an externally spun fibrous protein secretion formed into fibers, usually resulting in material structure such as cocoon or web. Silk are essentially protein with sugar and minerals in some systems. Silk have been using as textile for 5,000 years. Reason for this long time use are unique luster, tactile properties, durability, and dyeability. Silk fibers are remarkable materials displaying usual mechanical properties, strong, extensible, and mechanically compressible. Silk also display interesting thermal and electromagnetic responses, particularly in UV range. So silk has fine and uniform diameter and high strength and dyeability over a range of temperature and humidity. With improved analytical technique together with the biotechnology, a new generation of silk related materials is envisioned that depart from the traditional textile and medical sutures. The unique and remarkable mechanical properties of silk has been studied for their appreciation in high performance materials. A number of consumer products are already promulgated based on silk industry cosmetics, hair replacement, shampoos, among others, using Bombyx Mori silk. Bombyx Mori silk already used in those appliances, but non-mulberry silk, it is just coming up. Then sutures, biomaterials for tissue repairs, wounds, coatings, artificial tendons, bone repairs, and related may be possible applications, since silk are less compatible and newly slowly degrade in the human body. Study reveals non-mulberry silk as compatible as mulberry silk, and in some cases better than Bombyx Mori silk. So those are scientific studies, and already reveals that silk can be used in textile is a good, and textile is old age commodity. Silk is a commodity for textile for time immemorial, but nowadays there all other dimension also open up. So silk is, that is why it is going more and more precious. Thank you for listening, and thank you for giving me this opportunity to talk to you a little bit whatever we have done and whatever it could be done with silk. Thank you.
Thank you, madam, for an excellent presentation. Silk, the queen of textile. Now, the session is open for question, answer, and discussion. If anybody has any discussion with our respected speakers, they can put it in the chat box or ask them directly by unmuting. I will also request our host, Dr. Pawan Kumar Sharma, sir, to coordinate.
I don't hope any question will be there, because everything was informative, unique information for us. We didn't know anything about this line, no doubt. We have very much enlightened by the speakers. Now I would like to, before concluding remarks by respected Vishnu Prasad Sharma ji, I would like to request Professor Madan Thangavelu from UK to bless us with few valuable words. Dr. Madan Thangavelu ji.
जी नमस्कार.
Namaskar.
Namaskar.
Vishnuji, Namaskar.
Namaskar.
Namaskar to all our wonderful speakers today. It has been an amazing journey. When Pavanji was organizing this, he was saying, how are we going to connect these two things? It's a very important day, the National Handloom Day. But how are we going to connect this? And he was confused. But today he has shown how we can bring together so many important threads, which are all interrelated in many, many ways. And I want to particularly highlight the connection, the presentation by Anisha Ji. So before I do that, apologies that we feel sorry for the bandwidth problems on some of the presentations. So we missed some very high quality information that was being shared. So I hope we will resolve that somehow, maybe in a future presentation. But I want to touch briefly on initially Dipali Deviji's presentation, which took us into the deep biology of how silk is produced, and particularly the aspect about Moga silk. Moga silk is naturally golden colored silk. Here in the UK, there are some specialist shops that sell Moga silk fiber. Let me give you a link. I will put the link here on the website. It costs about £10 for 50 grams of Moga silk. So I don't know how much Moga silk is, what the cost is where in Assam where it's produced. But here, when it comes to the retail market, 50 grams of Moga silk fiber costs £10. So that is a lot of money. So it's just to say the value of this material and the beauty of this material. Number two, I want to touch briefly on Anisha Ji's presentation, and that took us into this connection between the big area that is in everybody's mind, sustainability, and this one earth, one health idea. That was a good introduction of how a lot of material that is produced is unused and a waste of resources. So there is a very strong theme there. Thank you, Anisha Ji, for your wonderful presentation. Very exciting. Thank you for highlighting. I will put my contact details here for you.
Yeah, sure. Thank you so much.
Very clear. It was very clear and very touching. And some of the images you showed and what you told us about microplastics and how they come about is very interesting.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Now, I also was very moved by Tanga's presentation. Now, it was a complete surprise to hear the number of Ayurvedic herbs that are used in the textile industry. So congratulations, Tanga Kumar, for your superb presentation. We would like very much a longer presentation from you at some point. I don't know when, but we would like very much a longer presentation from you where you will tell us in a little more detail how you make your the different steps. You gave us a very nice slide where you showed us how you do the kashayams in particular, for instance. And I want to see, and I like what you said about the sleep promoting material and the use of cotton and the use of dyed material and how it, the interaction with the skin. And you are teaching us many things here. You are observing something that the customers are feeling. So people who use your fabric are feeling something. And the challenge for us is to understand how to decode that feeling. Because a lot of people will say, well, this is not, you know, it is some effect which is, there is no basis for it. But I feel there is a strong basis for it. And I want to make a comment here, which might seem very strange. And I'm going to see if I can make this the connection with some of the chemicals that are being used here. So first of all, many of the chemicals that are used in the dyeing process are also pharmacologically important chemicals. So gallic acid and its derivatives. So when we look at Trikatu and we look at the chemicals and why they are so beneficial for our health when ingested, is because of a collection of chemicals, the gallic acids and the related compounds, and the way they interact with the body is understood. But what is also clear is that the interactions that we understand using classical chemistry, there are much more deeper principles there. There are much deeper principles than the classical chemistry interaction. So what Thangaji's presentation is saying, when he says you can put the chemical on the sheet, and when you sleep on the sheet, it promotes your health. Now, this is a very interesting comment. And to understand this comment, you have to go into the world beyond the understanding of chemistry, and we have to go into the world of electrodynamics. Now, this is a very new area. It is an area that is still being researched. So, Thangaji, your comment touches very nicely. I'm holding one book here that I'm studying now. It's the biophysical aspect of coherence in biological systems. It's a very, very important area, and this might be the future of many aspects of green health. There is a big interest around the world on the green economy and how to reduce all these pollutants that are going into our water, how to reduce usage of unwanted chemicals. And we feel that area of biology that touches coherence and the biophysics of coherence. It's a very young area, although there is a lot of fundamental material that is there. Now, this connects all of the things that we are talking today. It connects Ayurveda, it connects the green economy, it connects rural skills and development and rural employment. It touches the future of where we want the one planet, one world, one health agenda that Prime Minister Modi presented at the G7 summit. So we are sitting here in a wonderful seminar, which looks very informal, but the content of this seminar has deep implications for policymakers. So I'm hoping that Pavanji and Vishnuji and all the others here will somehow make the connections and influence policymakers, maybe through the ministries, you know, maybe through Assam and the ministry. The current minister of Ayush is a former chief minister of Assam, and maybe we should bring all these things into that discussion so that people like Vishnuji can take a message to the ministry, Ayush ministry, saying, you know, we hear from people that there are more opportunities in these things. I finally finish with one comment. Now, if this is the case, if what Thanga Kumarji is saying, that if you just have to put the material with Trifala extracts on your skin and it helps improve the blood circulation, we will be able to measure this. We just need to keep a cloth on the skin and we can do physiological measurements of changes in blood flow. So it is not rocket science, as they call it. It is something that everybody is doing. We can go to All India Institute of Medical Science in New Delhi or All India Institute of Ayurveda and ask them to do this experiment. Say, put cloth in Trifala and put it on your skin and see if the blood circulation improves. So there is very high science and there are very beautiful things that can come out of this informal gathering that we've had today on the Handloom Day. So I feel excited. I will discuss offline with Vishnuji and also with Pavanji on how we can take this message to people in New Delhi so that we can find those niche areas. These are very niche areas where there is immense scope for the future. Now, I said I will finish off with one comment. That comment is about the reverse of this process. So what Thangaji is saying, you put use only cotton because it is good for the environment. There are no microplastics produced. What Anisha Ji said, when you wash polyester clothes, small nanoparticles of plastics are produced. This is a big issue the world over. The question I want to ask is, if Thangaji is saying, if you put a cloth in Trifala Kashayam and then dry it and use it as a bed sheet, it improves blood circulation, there's a physiological effect. Is there a negative physiological effect if you are using polyester clothes? And I think we might uncover something there. And I particularly want to put this in the context of chronic diseases. You know, I think with increasing polyester usage, it is an avoidable fact that there is an increase in polyester use in clothes and fabric around the world. And we are also seeing an increase in some ill health. And so I'm taking Thangaji's suggestion, which I think is very correct, and turning it around by saying, are those artificial fibers causing ill health for us? So I leave that with that comment. And you have given me a lot to think about, Pavanji, and all the speakers have been wonderful. And Dipaliji's comment about the special silk, whether that has a health promoting activity, is also an area that can be considered. So thank you very much, Pavanji, for asking me to just give a few thoughts on this occasion. I feel excited. I feel there is a strong message we can take to New Delhi out of the conclusion of this webinar today. So namaskar. To everybody who presented, thank you very much.
Excellent, sir. In our Ayurveda also.
Thank you very much, Thangavaluji. So actually that export price for Muga silk, I cannot say, but the local value in our market, it is a plain clothes, 1 meter clothes.
You are muted, madam. Kindly unmute yourself.
Yes. Yeah, that local cost for that 1 meter clothes, plain clothes, that cost 5,000 or 6,000. And if it is designed with some flowery designs, local handmade design, then one sari, it cost 45,000-46,000 right now. But export value, I cannot comment on that. And again, thank you for comments, and that Muga silk have the highest UV protective capacity, that is more than 80%. And durability, that is strength is highest, that is more than Bombyx Mori silk. That is why it is usable in clothing, and it goes for more than 50 years. That is third generation, they can wear a clothes. And it shines after every wash, it shines more. So that is the beauty of the color. That color itself is a golden brown color. And that color shines more and more after successive washing. That is the beauty of the clothing. So that is why the price is very high for Muga silk. And other thing is the production is very low because it is that production site is concentrated only the Brahmaputra Valley and some foothills, but not more than 500 meter above. That food plant that does not grow above 400 meters above. That is why that food plant's growing areas is very narrow and production is low.
What was the natural chemical you mentioned, ISO, that gives the golden color to the fiber?
Isoeugenol, that is from food plants, and methyl isoeugenol, that is remain in the fiber itself.
Dipaliji, could you please put the names of those two chemicals on the chat, in the chat box, please?
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm just giving you.
Thank you so much.
Our Ayurveda also, sir, in past 3 decades of my clinical practice, I have observed various skin disorder cases due to this polyester and artificial clothing.
You have
generally we advise patients of psoriasis or eczema to avoid triple S: synthetic cloths, salt, excessive salt, and sour. No khatta, no namak, and synthetic cloths. So this is very common factor.
So many people can benefit from this information. Pavanji, you have offered some very important insights on how the not everybody, some people will be sensitive, you see. So this is the important point. I think we should understand who are the people who are reacting to this and why they react to this. But those reactions goes into the sukshma, Pavanji. This is an important point, you know. The stula aspect is what chemistry is telling us, but when we go into the sukshma aspect, then there is some interaction between, you don't need to ingest the chemical, there can already be an interaction. In Ayurveda, you say, in some places, you don't need to take the herb, you just put the herb onto your body or in a packet in your body, you know. So these are the sukshma aspects, and I think this is a very important area of Ayurveda. I hope we will have a meeting sometime on the sukshma aspect of aushadis, you know. Mm-hmm. And because Tanga Kumarji, what he is saying is pointing to that understanding the sukshma aspect also.
Dr. Jayesh Thakkarwal is recommending one sukshma aushadi expert from Maharashtra. We will call him. We will invite him with regards, and we will have his views on sukshma. So now I would like to request Professor Vishnu Prasad Sharma ji for his concluding remarks.
Okay, namaskar, respected Professor Madan Thangavaluji, respected Professor Nilufar Nahar, Pavan Kumar Sharmaji, moderator Dr. J.S. Thakkar, dear distinguished speaker and learned audience. It was a pleasure listening to such insightful talk on Ayurveda, natural cloth with herbal touch from eminent speaker. Therefore, today's talk on Ayurveda, natural cloth with herbal touch was significant. First of all, I offer my sincere thanks to eminent speaker, Dr. Shambhunath Chattopadhyay, for his wonderful presentation. He delivered lecture on coloration of natural fiber textile using natural dye. He said natural dyes are collected from plants, explained nicely advantage of natural dyes, limitation of natural dyes, again, classification of natural dye based on origin, nicely explain more denting, explain healing effect of natural dye. So thank you, Dr. Shambhunath Chattopadhyay, for your excellent presentation. Next, I would like to offer my sincere thanks to Dr. Bhuvan Chandra Setia for wonderful presentation. He nicely described regarding Eri Muga silk, nicely showed the natural dyed plants. Thank you, Dr. Bhuvan Chutia, for wonderful presentation. Next, I would like to offer my sincere thanks to Mrs. Onisha Khiani. He spoke on regarding importance of Ayurvastra, Pavitra Vastra, importance of natural fabrics and natural dye, nicely described fast fashion, why fast fashion bad, natural and handmade fabrics, explain advantage of natural fiber, and natural and herbal dyeing. So thank you, Mrs. Onisha Khiani, for your wonderful presentation. Now I'd like to offer my sincere thanks to Mr. Tanga Kumar for excellent presentation regarding Ayurvedic textile. He nicely explained how Ayurvedic vastra or Ayurvedic textile help in the skin. He nicely described regarding haldi cloth and trifala using bed cover, how it helps in the body. How do you answer? Thank you, Dr. Thanga Kumar, for your excellent presentation. Next, I would like to offer my sincere thanks to Dr. Mrs. Dipali Devi. She told that silk is a queen of textile, explained vividly about the silk, explained nicely life cycle of Muga silk worm. She showed some of the handloom product and showed silk biomaterial. Thank you, Madam Dr. Mrs. Dipali Devi, for your excellent presentation, and thanks to Professor Nilufar Nahar and Professor Dr. Madan Thangavalu for joining the meeting. Namaskar to all. Namaskar, Pavanji. Namaskar.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you all. Hari Om. Good night.